SMU as an offensive coordinator, and I'm looking forward to today's game. This is our first of six SMU broadcasts this year. These two teams have both changed offenses a little bit in the course of the offseason, but they both still revolve very much around good running backs.
Oh, you got to have the running backs, and of course, both of them have them. Jeffrey's over to that TCU, and Jeff Atkins at SMU. Fine, fine back.
Yeah, Jeff Atkins, of course, one of the great running backs in SMU history, fifth on the all-time list, or about to become fifth, and this is the Rice game where he had over 100 yards. Well, you know, he's the last of the Pony Express. He's got it all by himself this year. Everybody else has already graduated and gone, and he's going to carry the mail, and he's going to carry a lot of it. Talk to Coach Whitey and the offense coordinator, and they want him to carry the football about 23 times and get about 130 yards.
And Tony Jeffrey of TCU, the nation's leading rusher after a great game against Tulane and a pretty good one last week against Kansas State.
Well, barring the time from Coach Whacker, he was unbelievable. You just don't expect the back to have that type of yardage first ball game. And again, a shuffle pass here, and he can catch the football. He's got good hands. He's a great back, and he's off to a tremendous start.
That 343-yard game against Tulane 2 weeks ago in the season opener set a Southwest Conference record. As an old coach, contrast the two men who'll be coaching today's game, Jim Whacker and Bobby Cox.
Well, I tell you, that's going to be fun. Both are very successful. Both towns and both athletic directors. I love the coaches. Coach Whacker now, he's going to get excited on the sideline. His clipboard, he may fly it down and he may throw it. His hair's going to be going all directions. And Mr. Tune Common selects Coach Collins. And he may be a pretty good poker player because you really don't know what he's thinking, and he keeps all his motions inside. Both are great coaches.
Both of them very successful. The Horned Frogs come in 2-0, SMU 1-1. We're ready to kick it off, and Chuck and I will be back in a moment.
It's certainly been all SMU, but I believe this thing's coming back around. Coach Whacker stated earlier this week that this is his best group of players to knock off SMU, and he's added the wishbone with his attack, and with a few more guns there, and he's upgraded every year on his recruiting. This could be the year that he knocks them off.
Now look at the temperature for a fall afternoon on a Saturday, 94 degrees with 85% humidity could play a part in the ballgame.
But it sure could. Both teams are showering depth, and I was on the sidelines a while ago, and that 94 degrees is much hotter than that.
And a look at the officials, all from the Southwest Conference. This is the SWC opener for TCU, the second game in the Southwest Conference for the Mustangs. They beat Rice 45-3 on the opening weekend, lost 30-0 last week at Arizona State. Horned Frogs own victories over Tulane and Kansas State. TCU won the coin flip, and they elected to choose their option in the second half. So the Mustangs will receive the kick, and TCU will be defending to the goal 2 year right. If you get a look at Jim Whacker, 49 years old, 16th season as a head coach. The last time TCU beat SMU was 1971, and Whacker was a rookie coach at Texas Lutheran that year. To give you some perspective of how long it's been, and WC Nix, the fine offensive lineman for the Horned Frogs, was 7 years old. It's been a while.
Yeah, and Whacker said it was murder. It just hadn't been that type of series.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, Jimmy Young, a freshman, is the deep receiver for the Mustangs, along with Kobe Morrison, number 47, to the bottom of your screen. And in just a moment, and the man to the top of the screen will be Mitchell Price, also a freshman. And the kicker at the 35-yard line is Lee Newman out of Garland. Good kicker. Both teams sporting very good kicking games. You get a look at Jimmy Young.
And you know, both kickers are from Garland also.
That's right. Brandy Brownlee had a 57-yarder last year that beat Texas Tech, so he has a good leg. And so far, Lee Newman
Warren told me earlier this week that they were going to hand the football off to Atkins early in the ball game. He's had a trouble. He's having trouble fumbling the football, but he's been getting the football early in the game on a pitch. This time they handed it off to him. He needs to have a good start. He's going to have a good day.
Waters, Atkins, Kobe Morrison, who played the first series or the first play. Jacobs, Ron Morris, a great receiver who's given TCU trouble over the years. But one of your former UTA players, Tony Brown, in the game. The lead blocker on this carry is Atkins. Punches it out to about the 28-yard line. That'll set up third and about 2.5. A tackle made by senior Kevin Dean, the leading tackler on the team.
You know, I noticed then that they brought Ron Morris in to the slot back, and you can look for him to receive some pitches today on the option play as they will be faking to Jeff Atkins and or Kobe Morrison and pitching it to Ron Morris. This is a new little wrinkle.
Here's a third down play out of the I formation. Albert Reese to tie it in, and it's Ron Morris in motion against the four-man look for the Frogs on defense, and Atkins picks his way out to just past the 31, but Chucky needed to gain almost the 32. Andy Pitts brought him down. That will be awfully close. I'm not sure he made it.
I don't think that he made it, but it was a counter sweep play. They made motion towards the right side of the field and came back to the short side, and TCU did a good job of holding him. Andy Pitts, the linebacker from Alvarado, married a cute little girl from Cleveland, Texas.
Here's the punt for Dodge Carter, a good one. Good kicker he is, and a pretty good punt coming toward the near sideline to Tony Brooks. Another one of those young Horned Frog players, a flag down last week. Punt returns killed SMU. It was a 65 and a 54-yarder, and that really helped Arizona State on their way to that 30-0 win, and we'll check the flag here.
Well, I tell you, last week they tried going with their old reliable, the starters, covering their punt, and they were getting tired. They didn't do a good job of covering. This week they got younger players, more enthusiastic players, players that want to be on those specialty teams, and they did a good job on their coverage on the first punt.
And they also get a 15-yard clipping penalty tacked onto that, so the Horned Frogs will be pinned back as we get ready for their first offensive series of the afternoon. Both young quarterbacks guiding these teams. Waters is now a junior. It's his first year of starting, so he still has another year to go. David Rasko, a sophomore out of Houston who got a baptism by fire.
Run back. First down.
As you hear the officials tell us about the clipping call, look at the offensive line. W.C. Nix starting at center today. They've done some shuffling on their offensive line. Clint Haley, one of your former players, injured last week, so they brought W.C. Nix into the center position, and we'll set some of those other changes as on first down. The Horned Frogs go at right tackle for not much yardage available. Scott Bednarski, the initial ball carrier, as they go out of the wishbone. They've been doing a little of both so far this year.
That's right. You can look for the wishbone on first down situations, second and short yardage situations, and when they get into goal line situations. That's their tough yardage offense.
Tony Darthard is a true freshman. One of only a handful of those playing for the Horned Frogs. And out of the wishbone again, Rasko will option. This is Tony Jeffrey's first carry, and he gets around the corner. Frankie Thomas brings him out of bounds after a nice game. That should be first down yardage for the Horned Frogs in the opening first down of the afternoon.
I'll tell you what, I like this David Rasko. He's getting smoother and smoother. And old number five, Scott Antrim, may have a hard time getting his job back, but he's the one that made that play work.
Check Jeffrey's statistics. 400 yards gained, 397 actually net. Six touchdowns, that leads the nation. He is the number one runner in the nation, averaging 12 yards a carry.
Can't say enough about him. Here's the bone right here.
There's the bone again on first down. Not much available on the wishbone that time, though, as the Mustangs, led by Jerry Paul and others, deck Rasko for a slight loss on the play.
I'll tell you what, Oklahoma, the linebacker to that side, shot to the inside and got there at the mesh point, and that's the way you're going to stop the old option play.
Ben Hummel was questionable early in the week, suffered a bruised hip, actually a hip pointer, very painful football injury against Arizona State, but he's out there. Jared Delaney, at the top of your screen. You just barely see his feet at the top of your screen. He actually started the game today and plays for Keith Burnett. Pressure on Rasko, gets away from Jerry Ball. They may have called him down. I believe we'll wait for the indication. Jerry Ball got him after Eichmann flushed him out of the pocket, Chuck. And the SMU fans want a fumble, but they say Rasko was down.
You know what? We may need the replay official on this call because it certainly did look
gets it out to the 22, and so it looks like these two teams will trade punts here early on. So a big defensive play in the opening series. After TCU gets a first down, they drive them back.
And it was Mr. Ball. He made the turnaround for FMU defense.
Chris Becker will do the punting, and Jimmy Young will do the receiving on this one. Becker averaging almost 48 yards a kick, and his net is 43-4. He is one of the top punters in the Southwest Conference, and they really covered kicks well, and this is a solid kick to Young at about the 32. There to get him, Billy Tominey, the first man to make contact. And better field position on this drive for the Mustangs as their defense holds, and here comes SMU's second try of the afternoon.
Especially teams were looking good and showing signs that locker work was done in that direction this past week. They filmed the workouts on Tuesday and evaluated early Wednesday. So Wednesday on is when they smooth out, and they've spent a lot of time, both teams, on specialty teamwork.
Bobby Waters, the quarterback, the I formation. Waters completed 13 straight in the opening game against Rice, a new Southwest Conference record. And here's the pitch to guess who? Atkins, high-stepping his way out to almost the 50-yard line. Looks like the opening SMU first down of the day. Garland Littles brought him down.
Well, it's important that Atkins gets off to a good start if he's going to have a good day, and that's what the SMU coaching staff feel like. And they were worried on that first pitch because he has had a habit of fumbling early in the ball game, running out to play and receiving the pitch. He fielded that one nicely, got the first down, and off to a good start.
Well, he is closing in on all sorts of career records, career numbers at SMU. Could this year with a great season, as the pass is way short out in the flat. As Waters hits the deck, he was looking for Ron Morris out there. But Atkins is closing in. It's clear it's going to be second and 10. Atkins is closing in on some career marks at SMU. He needs 1,103 yards, really actually less than 1,100, to get into second place on the all-time list and maybe pass his old buddy Reggie DuPart.
He'll probably make it.
He may make it with a big season, and the Mustangs want him to have one, obviously. And again, he is doing most of the work at tailback this year alone. This time they give it to him out of the draw, but there was some motion along the line of scrimmage on second and 10 before the play could get underway. 10-11 to go here in the first quarter. Glad you're with us here on Channel 21.
Bill, looking back to the play before this, you see the patch floor there? I believe that's where water slipped down when he started to plant and make his throws to the left. Of course, this penalty will get him away from that patched up piece of carpet there.
He took over. Okay, so a false start offense cost SMU 5 and sets up a 2nd and 15. And got a shot a moment ago of Waters, who, under some pressure, taking over after successful runs at quarterback from Lance McElhaney and Don King. But his teammates love him. He's a very quiet young man, but very accurate with his passing and a pretty good option quarterback. This time you would expect a pass, and on a rollout, he's looking for Morris in the flat, overthrows. He overthrew his first pass. Threw his first pass of the season against Rice into the carpet, and after that he completed 13 in a row, so maybe this will be a good omen for the Mustangs.
Well, he's got lots of good touch. He's a good athlete, and they're going to need to get the football to the wideouts, Long Marsh and Jacobs. They're two fine athletes, and then occasionally give it to Atkins, and occasionally pull someone and give it to the fullback, and here we go. We need to overcome this penalty.
Jed Martin, a sophomore, and at fullback, lead blocker for Atkins, and on the draw, Mustangs taking no chances here, hoping actually that they can spring that one for a big game, but nothing doing, as the Horned Frogs, who have been maligned a bit over the past couple of weeks defensively, use a tackle from Chris Shaw and others to set up another SMU punt. So trade kicks here in the early going. Both teams get a first down, but can get a little more, and now it's a battlefield position here early going.
3rd and 15, not a bad play, that old draw play.
Sometimes works for big yardage. Not a Dodge Carter-like punt here. A bit short. Will bounce and take a TCU bounce. So Tony Shellman, check that, Kobe Morrison, downs it at the 35-yard line. And midway through the opening quarter here at the Cotton Bowl, no score. Mustang and the Horned Frogs. We've really done wonders with the TCU program. Had that 8-4 season 2 years ago, but still hasn't beaten the Mustangs yet, and that's something that he made no secret about wanting to do earlier this week.
You know, he's going to get that old clipboard warmed up before the day's over. Of course, they're facing sun over there, and it's already hot, but Coach Wacker is very emotional.
Well, no question who SMU is shooting at offensively so far. They've given the ball 5 times already to Atkins, and here's Darthur's carry on first down. Tony D'Arthur will get three or four, and guess who brings him down? Jerry Ball, hard man to run around. They've gone to the 4-3 look this year defensively, and they say it allows a little more freelancing, less double-teaming on Ball up front, lets him do a few more things.
Well, you know, they can move Ball all the way over to the opposite tackle. He can still cover the other side of the field. He's got such good lateral movement. Fine pro prospect.
Merritt has a little baby girl that he had during the offseason. Second and 7, 9 minutes to go here in the opening quarter, and the pitch to Tony Jeffrey. Uh-oh. Jeffrey with running room past the 50-yard line, broke a couple of tackles. John Eichmann and Jerry Ball, Toby Watts, finally made the tackle, but I saw Eichmann and Ball grabbing for nothing but air out there, Chuck.
Well, I tell you, Jeffries is real strong, especially with thighs, and when he gets turned upfield, you got to get more than just an arm in front of it, and he did a fine job on the option play.
Two carries for Jeffrey for 20 yards, and a first down, second of the afternoon, unofficially for the Horned Frogs to continue to go out of the wishbone set. Keith Burnett at the bottom of your screen. Scott Bednarski.
You know, that's a play, Bill, they haven't been running the first two ball games. Coming out of the bone, the quick trap right up the middle, and strongly they flipped the two guards.
Bednarski is a junior from Austin. You take a look at his 86 stats so far. His father, for you wrestling fans, is Ivan Kutsky. That's not his, obviously not. Kutsky is not his real name, but
how they thought that name was.
I don't know, but Bednarski is quite proud of that. In fact, he does some off-season wrestling also, I'm told. Second and 2, 8 minutes to go in the quarter, and the Horned Frogs get another first down. Nothing fancy about that, Chuck. It's just straight-ahead stuff, and Bednarski does it again.
Oh, bread and butter. They will ride that fullback. If he's got a chance to make the marks or the necessary yardage, they let him have it. If not, they pull the ball back out. The quarterback has the option of keeping it or pitching. You've got to put a man on the dive man. You've got to put a man on the quarterback. And you've got to put a man on that pitch man, which usually is old Jeffrey.
Wayne Waddy into the game. He's a speedster, number 26 in there. Height set in the backfield. Bednarski, D'Arthur, Jeffrey, Wishbone. Brasco will pitch it to Jeffrey. Not much available this time. They caught him on the short side of the field. And among others, Derek Reed, A.J. Miller, and Frankie Thomas team up over there to make the stop. Frankie Thomas follows some very good players in the SMU secondary. Rod Jones, the number one pick this year by Tampa Bay, was a starter for the Mustangs last year. They produced Reggie Phillips of the Bears, Russell Carter of the Jets, Wes Hopkins of the Eagles. Four straight years they have produced starting defensive backs in the NFL. Here's a second down and about 9, and Rasko wants to throw one, and he will have his man, Jared Delaney.
I tell you what, TCU looks real. They look quicker than I've seen them in the last several years, and they've just got a flock of little backs who can run and catch and get to the outside, and now it's time for SMU to bear down.
Now take a look at it on slow motion here. Delaney was a highly recruited wide receiver out of Houston who last year caught 16, 2 touchdowns, averaged 18 yards a pop. And a third and short upcoming here. Out of the bone again. This is D'Arthur, and he'll easily get the first down as he tight ropes his way down to the 25-yard line. And again, SMU looks a little bit, well, a little off balance here in the early going.
For the old power sweep play. That's a good old-fashioned single wing play where the quarterback just turns and pitches it to the off-half back, and he follows his blockers and turn up any time that there is a crack or a crease, and he carried it all the way to the sideline in order to get his 2 yards for the first down.
The guy who threw the nice block there was Tony Jeffrey. Well, he not only runs well, but that time he helped his teammate out with a good block in motion out of the wishbone this time is Bednarski. Straight dive, Jeffrey in easily. Tony Jeffrey got a super block from Mike Kula, and there is a touchdown from just over 20 yards away. And so TCU is on the scoreboard. They scored first. what impresses me. And 2.5 games, or just over 2 games, 12 yards a carry coming in. Young, Price, and Kobe Morrison. Jimmy Young, the man in the middle, the guy you're looking at right now. He's the fellow who normally returns the kicks for SMU, has returned coming into today, averaged about 19 yards a return, and pretty much did that on his first kickoff. This one will carry near the goal line, and here comes Jimmy Young again behind a wedge. He has some room.
Yes, he does.
And there he goes for a nice gain, but flags all over the place, Chuck, and that normally means that it comes back.
It sure does, and when things happen bad in that direction, seem like they just come in clusters. This is something that SMU doesn't need to overcome or have to overcome at this time, as they were detected.
There's a 34-yard return. See if we can pick it up. Look at the wedge. He outruns the wedge, and Kobe Morrison at the bottom of your screen may have been the guilty party, because a Horned Frog player was about to go past him when Kobe threw his block. Didn't get a good look at it on the replay, but that would be speculation that perhaps he was the guy who did the clipping at that time, if that's indeed what it was. A hold, maybe. Let's see. It'll be some kind of an infraction, and we will get the indication.
10-yard holding during the run back.
Okay, I'm glad I said holding after I said clipping, because holding is 10, 5 yards less than clipping. So instead of a 15-yarder, it's a 10, but it still pins SMU back at their 13-yard line. No surprises in the backfield. Tony Brown, UTA, gets his first carry of the day, and Chuck Curtis will be mighty proud of a spinning move like that. He played tailback for you last year, and when the program at UTA disappeared, he came over here.
Tony Brown can play anywhere. He's a complete football player. He's the difference than Denison winning the state championship his senior year than them being just state finalists. He can block, he can run, he's a good linebacker, and he catches football. I like to say lots of good things about Tony, because he's a high-class, right type of individual.
Obviously, Bobby Collins and company came to you when they were thinking about signing him last year, and it's a wise move, because he has tailback speed. So does Jeff Atkins, and look at him bully his way forward for 3 or 4 behind blocking of the left side of the line. So a quick first down for the Mustangs. They come back and set up a second and about, we'll call it 6 or 7. We'll call it 7. As they have, TCU leads them 7-0 after a 25-yard Tony Jeffrey run, and I'm sure the Mustang coaches are saying, ouch, because that one was so wide open.
I think SMU has accepted the challenge. They come off football better with the last play.
Very strong offensive line traditionally, and they've already gone to their second team to give their frontline guys a rest, and look at the yardage for Atkins. He'll get a first down. Now note, the second team offensive lineman, the so-called second team in there, number 78 is Tim Condren, number 76 is Doug Rice, Del Montgomery, number 72, Shelly Anderson is number 63, Kim Johnson, who did not start today at center, number 53, normally the starter, Atkins comes out of the game, 7 carries, 34 yards, and Darrell Terrell, a sophomore from Dallas's W.T. White High School, is in there along with Morrison behind Waters. So here's another first down and 10. And somebody jumped for the Mustangs. Looked like Del Montgomery on the right side. So this may cost them 5.
You know, I believe it was the second team line that was in there that scored the first touchdown in the Rice game. We've got that game going good for SMU.
That's been a tradition at SMU. They have developed their depth, particularly along the offensive line. They call it on TCU. That's an interesting call.
It is.
That's very interesting, because normally the defense can jump as long as they get back in time. Okay.
You got me on that one.
Yeah, I'm not so sure about that one, but anyway.
Illegal procedure against TCU.
All right.
You know, they're barking signals over there. use a different football team right now. Their concentration, their poise, they're getting off on the football. They're looking like a football team.
I'll give you Waters' numbers in just a moment. Coming in, he was completing 63% of his passes. He was in the top 15 in the nation throwing, 3 touchdowns. That was his first completion of this afternoon, 1-for-3. That 9-yarder to Jacobs, and this first down belly series play to Kobe Morrison will net him 3 or 4 more. Morrison from Dallas Spruce, he was recruited. Well, he played quarterback and running back in high school, came here as a defensive back, and then was shifted to running back, and he's done a good job over the years blocking for the past 2 years, Dupart and Atkins, and now mainly Atkins with Darrell Terrell in the backfield some.
He's run the gauntlet, you might say.
Absolutely. Here is a first down 10 for the Mustangs, and here's Darrell Terrell. Terrell will bully his way for about 3 more. David Caldwell brought him down, along with Mitchell Bibson. It's a very young defensive line for TCU. Ron Lewis, the regular starter up front, the sophomore. Mitchell Benson, a sophomore. Tracy Simeon is a sophomore. He has played 6 different positions since coming to TCU. David Caldwell is a senior, and Greg Jones is a junior. Simeon, and we'll tell you about him a little bit more, is right dead over the center, Tim Johnson, right now. As Waters gives it to Atkins, is back in the game, and in left tackle, Atkins, not a lot of running room there for him. Mainly, he made what he got before being brought down by Greg Jones and Mitchell Benson. Benson's a big kid. He weighs 280 pounds.
You know, coming out of high school, I thought Benson was one of the finest football players I've seen. He played fullback. He's played many different positions, and they've got him in the right spot. But, you know, he's played Atkins several times before over in the Fort Worth Independent School District.
That's right. Eastern Hills against Eastern Hills. Benson and Atkins, and here's Waters throwing. On third down, nice defensive play that time with no flags being thrown. Pass intended for Tony Shellman. And we'll try and check the number of the defensive player that time. That was Kevin Dean who got a hand in there. And that was that was awfully close to being pass interference, so close that it was just a great defensive play.
Good defensive play, one of those type that could go either direction, but Dean's a real fine linebacker.
Well, this one started at the 12-yard line, so this Mustang drive started way back at their own 12 following a holding penalty on the kickoff, and here's Brandy Brownlee to try a 44-yard field goal. Brownlee's kick on the way, and it is good. Brandy Brownlee nails a 44-yarder after kicking a 51-yarder against Rice, one of the best kickers in the league. The sophomore from Garland. You know, dancing you on the scoreboard.
I used to coach over at Old Garland High School, and I know his old mama and daddy, and I know they're real proud of Brandy right now.
You like that cowboy hat? Mandy Winger also joined the Mustangs for their picture session at Texas Stadium, where we will be broadcasting next Saturday night when Boston College comes to town. 10:30 to broadcast here on KPXA Channel 21, SMU and Boston College. You can get a look at some of the TCU supporters across the way from us. That was a 61-yard, 10-play drive that assumed a little over 3 minutes. Reggie Davis, one of the deep guys, along with Tony Brooks. Brownlee's first kickoff of the afternoon, carries to the 10. This is Brooks, and somebody got a hand on him down low and stopped him. Eric Mays was there to bring him down at the 26-yard line. TCU's 2 drives, 2 previous drives, 5 plays and a punt, 8 plays and a touchdown. A 65-yard touchdown drive that was culminated by Jeffrey's 25-yard run. That midway through quarter number 1. We're winding down the opening quarter here at the Cotton Bowl, the sesquicentennial edition of this matchup that dates way back to 1915. And here come the Horned Frogs. David Rasko, still a quarterback. Expect to see Scott Ankrum some this afternoon. Not much available on first down for Tony Jeffrey, diving at left tackle.
They ran the old veer to the left, and TCU calls that 43 veer left. And ball, defensive lineman, bet it to mesh point, and the quarterback would like to have got it out and gone on a little further, but things were stopped right at the starting point.
John Robinson from Houston, number 96, made the tackle. He's playing a defensive end opposite number 36, A.J. Miller. Jerry Ball, Terrence Mann, the tackle. Donald Allen out of Fort Worth, the man home. almost making the tackle on Rasko before he gets the pitch away to Tony Jeffrey, driven out of bounds by Derek Reed. Allen, the converted quarterback, who's been switched to defensive back this year after playing, or switched to linebacker this year after playing strong safety. And he almost got to Rasko, but that's the whole idea of the wishbone. Just as the man coming in goes after the pitch man, he just, or the quarterback, he throws to the pitch man, and Tony Jeffrey now with 6 carries for 53 yards.
You know, I'm impressed also with O'Terrence Mann, the left defensive tackle. He's moving good.
A parade All-American coming out of a Detroit high school. It's second down and 5, and here comes Jeffrey again, banging toward the first down, and may have it. They tackled him. A bunch of Mustangs were there to get him, but he fell forward. And Rudy Harmon and others were not able to stop the forward progress, and that is the first down. Another one for the Horned Frog.
Well, you know, talking to Bill Farton this past week, they said that they could be patient and just could keep the football. So they didn't want SMU to have it. Be patient, move the football, not necessarily come up with big plays, but sustained drives. They feel good about their situation to win the ball game.
Last week against Kansas State, they scored on 5 of their first 6 drives and then hit a dry spell in the second half, didn't score on their final 6, ended up winning 35-22. This is Bednarski again. Good yardage for Bednarski. Very impressed with him running out of the wishbone. That dive play is hard to stop when you've got a strong fullback.
A little quick trap. They have not been running that play. They haven't utilized the fullback yet, and I guess we can see why right now. They saved it for old SMU.
3 carries, 20 yards for Mr. Bednarski. And here is a second down and 2. Rasko on the keeper. Near side to Darther. The ball's loose, but out of bounds. He was popped out there by Rudy Harmon.
And the fumble progress helped him make the first down.
That's right. It did. Referees are very much watching the forward fumble this year, but that was obviously not intentional. He just got nailed by Harmon.
They detected it right that time.
That's right. That was a terrific shot. Caught him in midair, but a break for the Horned Frogs. He fumbles forward out of bounds for a first down. So the second first down of the drive, and here come the Horned Frogs into SMU territory. Again, out of the wishbone, and this time Rasko, off the play-action pass, will get Bednarski in the flat. That ball was tipped by somebody out there, but it went into the arms of Bednarski. Appeared to be tipped anyway.
Could have been a big play. He snuck out from his up-back position, and had it not been tipped, he might still be running.
And here is a second down and 6 after a nice defensive play by the Mustangs.
Terrence Mann, I believe.
Terrence Mann got a hand on it. Bednarski nicely coming back to the football to get something out of it. And with a backfield of Bednarski, Jeffrey, and Darther, here's Bednarski for big yardage, 16, maybe 17, and a flag down after the tackle. Maybe a late hit. That's the normal indication following a tackle. Ball all the way to the 31-yard line, and Bednarski all the way up to about 40 yards rushing for the afternoon. Let's get the indication. Face mask. And tack on some more. Horned Frogs unstoppable so far on offense in 3 drives.
Well, the discretion, where it's itching. You know, if the play will work, keep calling. And that's what Wacker's doing right now.
Broke a couple of tackles. Frankie Thomas, number 29, tried to make a tackle. And Reed, apparently the guilty party on the face mask. 4 carries, 32 yards officially now for Bednarski out of the fullback spot. They just keep hammering away. This is Tony Jeffrey, short side of the field. A lot of blue shirts there to get him that time, including Gabe De La Garza and Frankie Thomas. De La Garza, an interesting story. Toby Watts also there. De La Garza, an outstanding athlete, played behind Kit Case and T.D. Briggs last year. Now getting his chance to start. He's somewhat like Hakeem Olajuwon, the basketball player. He's from Monterrey, Mexico, or lived a couple of years, went to high school there. Hasn't played football that long, only about 5 years, but he's become an outstanding football player.
Played behind a couple of pretty good linebackers, too.
Absolutely. 2nd and 5, and this pitch coming to Pat Bradford. Check that, Bobby Davis. Davis, not much available, but he manages to squirt forward. Well, actually, got more than I gave him credit for. He may be close to another first down. Mann brought him down. Bobby Davis has averaged 9.5 yards a carry. Doesn't get the ball complete. Good play.
TCU almost doubling SMU in first downs, but only 20 seconds to go in the first quarter. Jeffrey gets little. Mann buries him that time. 273-pound senior Terrence Mann. And we are winding down the first quarter. That will probably be the final play of the quarter, and it will be as they change in. So an impressive opening quarter for TCU, and they're driving again. That's the end of period number one here at the Cotton Bowl with TCU leading SMU 7-3. That would probably be a nice guesstimation of this SMU-TCU crowd. Mustangs have won 14 in a row. TCU looking to snap that string. Jeffrey already 9 carries for 64 yards. And Chuck, a stat that we need to get into a little bit about TCU. Despite this option-oriented offense of theirs, they have not fumbled the ball yet. That fumble that Darthard had was the first fumble of the season, and they have not lost the fumble yet. And that's amazing going into the third game for an option team.
That's the number one thing in a coach's room. Thou shalt not beat thyself. And if you're not fumbling, you're not beating yourself.
Well, this is a 12-play drive. The 13th play goes to Bednarski again on 2nd and 10. And Jerry Ball, who had 14 tackles last week against Arizona State, and Terrence Mann wrap him up. Ball can beat double and triple team blocks. And that time, Bednarski was able to negotiate only a couple of yards as Jared Delaney comes into the ball game.
TCU has been very patient, but they've got a difficult decision to make here. 3rd and long, and do they run the option? Option pass? Let's see.
Delaney and Waddy. Delaney in motion. Waddy, the receiver at the bottom of the screen, and a pass upcoming here as Rasko rolls out. Hits Delaney on the sidelines, and he manages to juke Dick Sherrick. But Sherrick runs him out of bounds, and he'll be well short of the first down, but it will set up what should be a chip shot field goal for Lee Newman, who is 2 for 2 with field goals of 33 and 39 yards to his credit already this year. So that was the 14th play of the drive. And the Horned Frogs with Sean Millsap holding and Lee Newman from Garland. Lakeview Centennial High School, the same high school that produced Bobby Waters, will attempt what amounts to a 26-yard field goal. Kicks on the way. Mustangs think it's no good, and it is no good. It hooked off to the left.
You know, there's no gimmies. And kicking from the right hash mark seemed like for a sidelined kicker, it was more difficult. When you get back a little further, you've got more better angle. My kicker's always had difficult time on the right hash mark up close.
Kicking game's so much a part of college football. That's cliche, it's really, to say that, but it is indeed. Both these teams spend a full day of practice each week on nothing but the kicking game. And last week it killed SMU. Those two long punt returns hurt SMU badly, and I know they definitely spent a lot of time on it this week. Morrison and Atkins in the backfield behind Waters, who wants to go long. That is Ron Morris out there, but he overthrows it. Morris was being covered by Tony Brooks. Morris has burned TCU in the past. He caught an 80-yarder 3 years ago in Wacker's first season at TCU. That turned out to be the winning points in the ball game. It had 100-yard receiving days in his 3-year career against TCU.
He is an outstanding athlete. Come out of high school, I tried to get him playing an all-bowl game for me. He and Atkins both been that young. They turned me down the last week. We had a difficult time up at Wichita Falls, Texas.
Against those boys from Oklahoma, right?
That's right.
2nd and 10. Here comes Jeff Atkins picking his way to big yardage. That's a counter. Actually, he gets about 9 yards, almost 10 on the play, but runs about 15 to 18 yards to get that before he was brought down by Kevin Dean. That would be a little short of a first down.
Taking care of the pursuit of TCU. TCU is so anxious. They're going after the football, and it was the counter sweep. Started the direction to the right, and then just came back against the grain and let them over the pursuit.
9 carries, 45 yards. Here's a 3rd and 1, and they go to their full house power-eyed backfield for the first time, and Atkins dives ahead easily, getting the first down. That's something the Mustangs haven't changed much over the years. They love to run out of power-eye formation with a 3 running backs in the backfield on short yardage.
They sure do, and they run the option play good at it. The difference is that they ride Atkins in the tailback instead of the upback, and you've got to respect him, and then you've got the option coming after that, and usually they run to the short side of the field.
We have 3 of the top 4 runners in the Southwest Conference in this game today. Atkins is currently currently number two behind Tony Jeffrey in SWC stats. And here's Morris' first catch of the day. Watch out, because he has excellent free open field moves. Tony Brooks brought him down along with Andy Pitts, and that is close to another first down. Maybe another first down. They will measure. Nope, they won't even bother to measure. Ron Morris with a nice catch, his first one of the afternoon.
I'll tell you what, he just touched a little hitch pattern, and I believe that was called at the line of scrimmage because he wasn't covered, he wasn't doubled, and earlier in the week they were practicing. If they're not doubled automatically, let's go to Ron Morris whenever we can.
A big year for Morris. 48 more catches would allow him to pass Jerry Levias, one of your old players that when you were an assistant coach here, and be the number two all-time SMU receiver. Here is a first down carry. Guess who? Atkins again, and the bread and butter gets him about six more.
I think he's got the cobwebs dusted off of him now. He's running like his old self.
Andy Pitts brought him down. Colin said before the season started that with Dupard gone, that they would probably use the tailback spot less, but Dupard would carry more. Because Dupard and Atkins would carry more. Dupard and Atkins used to split the load as they did. Here's a second down and three. 12-13 to go in the second quarter, and this is Tony Brown again. And big yardage, another first down for Brown. I was looking at Bobby Waters. He did such a nice job of faking. He faked me out, and Brown gets the first down.
Bobby did a good job of faking. I'm a little worried about his shoes. He's been slipping and sliding. You notice the last couple times he dropped back on a straight drop back pass. He fell down the first time. He slipped the second time. And he may have to change shoes at the next time out or at halftime for sure.
Well, he needs to get the good footing because this is a good drive working here for the Mustangs. First and 10 into TCU territory. Your man Tony Brown again. Andy Pitts and Philandon Newton there to bring him down. Newton was injured last week, had an ankle problem, and missed the Kansas State game. That's about seven more yards for Tony Brown.
Tony's a strong football player. He's coming out. I think he's going to need some helmet repair. But from Denison, Texas, got a fine mama and daddy, and he's real happy at SMU, and we wish him the best.
Well, he had 638 yards and five touchdowns for you last year and didn't really play regularly until about the third game. And here comes Atkins around the corner this time and right tackle, but not much available on second down. Kevin Dean and Mitchell Benson brought him down. Dean had a chance to redshirt. Some of the TCU seniors redshirted this year because of the NCAA probation that has affected both these teams. Horned Frogs cannot go to a bowl game this year, neither can the Mustangs. We've talked at length about that in the past, so we won't get into that deeply, except to say that four of TCU's best senior defensive players chose to redshirt this year in order to have a chance at a bowl game next year, but the guy who made that tackle, Kevin Dean, was not one of them. He wanted to go ahead and play. Here's a third and two, trying to keep the drive alive. Kobe Morrison banging forward very close. They needed to gain just inside the 33-yard line, and Morrison's carry might have gotten it for them. We'll have to wait and see what they indicate here.
If he didn't, it's going to be a tough decision. We got to get White and Jordan and Coach Collins, and they got to get their heads together and massage it to decide what they're going to want to do, because this is an important play. That three-point missed field goal by TCU a while ago may be looming bigger and bigger as this game progresses.
I've got to go for this one, and they will. They're bringing Tony Shelman into the game as a second tight end. Brown's coming in. You've got to get the momentum back, and really TCU's had it so far. This is an opportunity for the Mustangs to get some of that back.
They didn't hesitate. Although they could be patient, there's lots of football left in this ball game.
Well, here is a full house backfield. Darryl Carroll's in the game. Power Eye, Tony Brown, and Kobe Morrison. Atkins rests on this one. This is a key fourth down play. Carroll will get it, and oh, he is close. The Horned Frogs are saying no. The Mustangs are saying yes. It'll obviously depend on where they mark it, and Bobby Waters says yes. But he doesn't count, so we will wait for the guys with the striped shirts to tell us about the forward progress.
This is one of those famous whether you get a left foot or a right foot mark, because it is close.
Oh, they'll measure again. I think he got it. I don't think from where I see the nose of the football and where I saw the yard marker, I don't even think it's close. I think it'll be 8 inches, more than that.
Oh, you got good eyes.
Now, Jim Wacker would... had he measured that one, he would have probably put the football back about it.
Funny how on the half. Whether one side of the field that you're on, they keep making different decisions.
Coaches become great
closer, and he held it just as long as he could, sprinting out to the left and let go and complete it to Reese.
Reese was being tended to on the sidelines in that last shot. Morris in motion out of the I formation. Martin and Atkins the back. Here's Atkins picking his way with very little available on a second down and four. So that'll set up a third down and a couple. Ron Lewis brought him down, a sophomore from Copperas Cove. So here's another third down opportunity coming up for both TCU's defense and SMU's offense.
SMU's been running a lot of misdirections, trying to slow down TCU's quick pursuit. TCU is quick.
Jeff Atkins has just passed Alvin Maxson and become the fifth all-time leading rusher. He needed 53. He has 56, so he has passed Alvin Maxson into fifth place on SMU's all-time list. Bobby Waters in trouble and manages to salvage something out of it on third down, but not much, and he may be short, and we may have another fourth down coming up here again.
Coaches hate these fourth down decisions. Clint, listen to the crowd to help decide what to do on this one.
Well, Waters is looking for help, and now I see down the way Milo McCarthy, one of the SMU assistants, sending Albert Reese in there. As Vince Jenkins, the tight end, comes out, and guess what? They're going for it again. Fourth down and inches with 8:15 to go in the second quarter. They don't need much. Full house backfield. Atkins, Morrison, and Tony
they may
Brown
throw out
there.
Of it. They may throw out of it.
They are going to throw. Open and complete to the seven is Kobe Morrison. Now, how about that?
That's a good call. Good time. Thanks a lot for courage. Lots of good. And hope you got some luck on your side and good execution.
That was an excellent catch by Morrison, who does not have many in his SMU career. Not only is it a gamble to throw, but it's a gamble to throw to a fullback. But they take the gamble.
Yeah, but he's played so many positions. You know, he's well suited. He's got the good foundation.
Well, here we go. First and goal inside the 10 in the full house backfield. It includes Jed Martin and Atkins, who has the ball and about 6 yards to the 3-yard line before Craig, behind Craig Kennington's block. Finally brought down by Garland Little and others. So the Mustangs, with an impressive drive, trying to take the lead here after a first quarter dominated, in my mind, by TCU.
Have they been staying in the power eye just a little bit more than I thought they would after visiting with them and watching workout this past week? But they got lots of confidence in it.
Reese and Shellman, the tight ends, numbers 88 and 48. Waters will keep it and go in standing up. Bobby Waters off a nice fake to Atkins, and everybody wearing a white shirt bought the fake, and Waters was able to skate in easily.
You've got to respect Atkins, number one.
And it was a good ride by Waters.
A good ride, and then all he had to do was walk in. Of course, he had the option to pitch, but, you know, being an old quarterback, when you get a chance to score, you just want to go ahead and take the set.
Waters had carried the ball only 13 times coming into today's action, but had scored a touchdown on the ground and had a 23-yard run to his credit. And so he scores his second rushing touchdown, has 3 touchdown passes, and here's Brandy Brownlee to try to make it a 10-7 ball game. And he does. So,
the old three-pointer that was missed a while ago. Bigger and bigger.
And 2 fourth down gambles pay off to the Mustangs, and they take the lead on a 2-yard Bobby Waters run. Middle of the second quarter, SMU 10, 7 minutes and 8 seconds, burned up a half a quarter.
I like it, man. Showing lots of poise and patience and confidence.
And Atkins already up to 14 carries for 62 yards. Jeffrey 9 for 64. So the two running backs are doing the bulk of the work, although there were 2 fourth down tries by SMU that worked as the kickoff goes out of the end zone for Brownlee. But those 2 fourth downs, 2 gambles by the Mustang coaching staff, particularly that second one to pass to Kobe Morrison, really paid off big.
Did you notice the kickoff? That's an example. After you score a touchdown, you get pumped up, that adrenaline is going, and kick the butt football through the end zone and out, and earlier been kicking it shorter.
Okay, Rasko, the quarterback. Well, I'll check my numbers on that before I say that definitely. We have a changing quarterback. So I spoke too soon. Scott Ankrum is in the game, the junior from San Antonio, who has not played much since this game a year ago. He played the entire SMU game and then was injured. Ankrum, a fine runner, and they'll let him run with it on first down.
They're going to test that leg, the pull of hamstring, right off the jump go. But they say he's the best athlete on the football team.
Well, 2 years ago when they went to the Blue Bonnet Bowl as a freshman, Ankrum played running back, played a little quarterback. He played defensive back. He scored. before he returned kicks, he scored touchdowns from at least three of those positions and had several big plays. He is a fine athlete.
And on the replay, Larry, I believe it's a call at the line of scrimmage.
And in motion comes Jeffrey, and Ankrum this time wants to do it all himself. Now, they have to probably get that. That's rustiness right there, wouldn't you say? As the Mustangs, Dick Sherrick and others, John Robinson dragging down. A little bit slow on the pitch that time, I thought. It'll take him a while to get the bugs worked out of it. But again, in the, about four games into the season last year, ligament damage for Ankrum. He has recovered fully from that. Then he gets here, and then he pulls a quadricep muscle in his leg. And so that keeps him, for the most part, out of the first ball game. That happened in the Tulane game. And here is a third down and three, and straight ahead power. This will get the first down for TCU.
Well, at this point, it looks like a good decision for Coach Quacker and his staff going to the wishbone, because they certainly have utilized it in the short yardage situations, critical situations, and it has not hampered them at all in the fumble department.
Scott Bednarski was the ball carrier a moment ago, 5:49 and counting towards halftime here at the Cotton Bowl. Out of the wishbone, Bednarski, Darthard, and Jeffrey appear to be the running backs, and this is Bednarski again. And Bednarski on first down will get about four, maybe five more. Toby Watt brought him down. A redshirt freshman from Aledo over in Tarrant County, or at least in that general vicinity. 5:20 to play here in the first half. Mustangs going with a defensive line of A.J. Miller, Terrence Mann, Jerry Ball, John Robinson, Rudy Harmon, Ken Masterson, Gabe De La Garza. The linebackers, that's the front seven. Here's the option to the far side. This is Darthard, and Darthard will get nothing. Mark Benson, who always gets fired up at TCU because he is from Fort Worth, went to high school at Country Day in Fort Worth, loves playing against TCU, has a lot of friends on the other side of the field, and he does a nice job that time against Darthard.
You know, he is an old ex-quarterback, too. He's run that option play many a time himself, and he stayed at home. Didn't get suckered in and made the tackle.
He actually came to SMU as a quarterback, wanted to be a quarterback. They moved him to the defensive backfield, tried to quit the team. They wouldn't let him, and now they're glad he stuck around. Here's a third down and five. Ankrum will keep it himself this time and thought about pitching. He is far short of the first down. That'll give a coach a heart attack because he thought about trying to shovel it off to Jeffrey at the last minute.
It likes the guy excited, I'll tell you the truth.
Rudy Harmon drove him down. Mustang defense holds, but I'll tell you something. This team has the makings of an offensive show because TCU is moving the football.
You know, things can break open any time. Defense right now is a little bit ahead. Breaks is a little bit ahead in the game, and those things have a way of bouncing out.
Jimmy Young, a redshirt freshman from San Antonio, who does the kick returning this year for SMU, is back deep. And a timeout called by TCU.
Looks like they're one man short on their punt team.
Not good. Late in the first half. Saw a game 2 weeks ago. Miami and Texas Tech were two punt blocks turned the tide. 10-7. SMU leading. Winding down the second quarter. Mustangs have taken the lead. We'll be back in on that last TCU possession. Four times they've had the ball. They have punted, scored a touchdown, missed a field goal, and now about to punt again. And this is Chris Becker, who is a sophomore from Taylor down in Central Texas, and again has had a fine career already. This is a low kick that most likely SMU's Jimmy Young will let bounce, which he obviously does, and the roll will get Becker a pretty good punt. He'll end up with over 40 yards on the kick in an 18-yard field position situation for SMU as they take over with 3:40 to go here in the second quarter. Again, the scores, a 25-yard Tony Jeffrey touchdown run in the first quarter. And then a Brandy Brownlee field goal. It was 7-3 in favor of the Horned Frogs. TCU misses a field goal, and that seemed to turn the tide. SMU comes back with an 80-yard drive. Bobby Waters scores. That's where it's at right now, 10-7. And the Mustang quarterback with three running backs in the formation, two running backs and Ron Morris back there, but nothing doing for Jeff Atkins. Morris, number 23, watch him, because he has been known to take handoffs and do reverses.
They're trying to figure different ways to get him to football. They just feel like that he's their big play operator, and they brought him back on the inside to be the pitch man. Of course, that time they didn't pitch.
Tracy Simeon, one of the tacklers there. Simeon came to TCU out of Sweeney. He's an outstanding lineman. Last year he played center. This year, because Kent Trammell decided to redshirt, they've made a nose guard. Showing blitz, the Horned Frogs looking that way. Jed Martin on a draw, not much available to him. They were sending several players on the blitz that time, and obviously the Mustangs were thinking that a draw play might work. It didn't. Andy Pitts made the stop, third and nine. 2:42 to play as my broadcast gets ready to go down toward the field to interview the coaches at halftime. Ron Morris and Jeff Jacobs, the wide receivers, so we'll be hearing from the two coaches at halftime. Bobby Waters wants to throw on third and nine, has time, and has his man Morris. Ron Morris at the 35 with running room and a blocker. He'll tightrope his way down the sideline into TCU territory at the 41-yard line. Ron Morris finally driven out of bounds by Billy Jones, and pass defense gave TCU all sorts of fits last week in the game against Kansas State. Particularly in the second half, only 142 yards for the game, but in the second half there were some problems for the Horned Frogs in that area, and Mr. Ron Morris, who has 4.5 speed in the 40-yard dash, definitely turns the corner that time. Jeff Jacobs threw a nice block for him out there, and here's another Mustang drive. 2:17 to play in the second quarter, and out of the draw, this is Atkins again, and he stiff-arms a couple of players, including Chris Shaw, and there may be a face mask penalty here. Could be against Atkins. Not against Atkins. That stiff-arm made me wonder for a moment. But the flags are all over the place as Atkins with a very tough stiff-arm. And all Chris Shaw could do that time was grab a face mask. And so this will help the Mustang cause considerably. And so tack on the penalty, 15 yards, bring it all the way down to the 24-yard line. So that play.
Personal foul, 15-yard face mask, first down.
They get about, 4 yards on the carry and then 15 more on the penalty, and all of a sudden, a drive that started inside their own 30, actually the 18-yard line, has now carried all the way to the TCU 24. Mustangs trying to get another score before halftime. Block in the flat by Tony Brown. Pass complete to Morris at the 20. Brought down by Billy Jones. Mustangs not afraid at all to pass. In fact, Waters' passing numbers are going up. We'll check that for you in a moment. Here's a second down and 5 upcoming for the Mustangs. Needing to gain inside the 19-yard line. Morris, 4 catches for 66 yards. Much of it on that play a moment ago that carried all the way to the 42. Here's the second and 5. Clock winding down toward a minute 20. And a quick hitter, not much doing that time for Kobe Morrison. Tracy Simeon brought him down again. And the Mustangs will call time. Bobby Waters will come over after using up the first SMU timeout of the first half. They have 2 left with a minute 18 to go as you take a look at Kobe Morrison. 10-7. Mustang leading and driving late in the first half. Solid first half for Bobby Waters. The touchdown run of 2 yards after missing his first 2 passes of the day. He's now 6 of 10 for 82 yards, 66 of those yards to Ron Morris on 4 completions. As the Mustangs burn a timeout, they have 2 left and a minute 18 to work with here, leading at 10-7. Horned Frogs led early in this ball game, and here we go on a 3rd and 6. The wide receivers in the formation, Jacobs and Morris to the bottom of your screen, and Waters wants to hit one of them. He'll go to Morris, who he gets away from the first man and gets down to the 8-yard line. Billy Jones had him well short of the mark. There is a flag in the backfield, though, and it'll be against TCU, a personal foul against TCU. So a break for the Mustangs. When you see the flag in the backfield, you wonder, but Morris does a very nice job here. Just a simple pass completion into the flat. Look at Billy Jones, number one. He has him, and that would have been short of the mark. And then Morris, on his own ability, beats Stanley Petrie to the corner. And that sets up the first down. down to the 8-yard line, and the penalty was a personal foul against Garland Little. It'll obviously be declined, and with a minute 10, it's first and goal Mustangs as Morris and Jacobs check out. Kobe Morrison comes into the game, and I'll bet you SMU comes out in their power eye set. Again, we'll be hearing from Chuck Curtis in just a moment. At halftime, he'll be with both coaches, Wacker and Collins. Power eye backfield, Brown, Morrison, and Jeff Atkins, who will get it off right tackle. Picking his way toward the five into a pile of blue shirts with a lot of TCU Horned Frogs on top. That'll set up a second down. Ball spotted at about the 6-yard line. Garland Little in on the tackle again. Mustangs, with 54 seconds and counting, winding down the half. As you look at Atkins' run that time, not afraid to stick it into the middle of the line. Atkins can go outside or inside. This time Waters will throw to a wide open Kobe Morrison, touchdown. The fake to Atkins opened it up. And the second pass completion to the fullback, Kobe Morrison. Waters again doing a very nice job with the sleight of hand off the fake to Atkins. And there is a 6-yard pass completion to Morrison. And that should be, that's only his second career touchdown at SMU. Last year, he had a 65-yard run against Texas, fumbled the ball. You saw the game here on Channel 21. Jeff Jacobs picked it up on the bounce and scored on a 95-yarder. Brownlee adds on the extra point. And with 40 seconds to go here in the first half, it is now 17-7 in favor of the Mustangs. So how quickly the fortunes turn here. Bobby Waters now 8 of 12 for 100 yards passing. And this one has definitely gone into SMU's favor. Waters off the play action. And look at that. Not much available. Ricky Rougely, number 6, was the closest man as Kobe Morrison goes in easily for the touchdown. So the Mustangs doing some different things than we normally see from them. You don't see much throwing to the fullback ever out of the SMU offense. That scoring drive, 9 plays, 81 yards, 3 minutes on the clock, consumed. And it's now 17-7 with only 40 seconds left to go here in the first half at the Cotton Bowl on a beautiful afternoon. It's rather humid out there. At least it was when Chuck and I walked down to the stadium floor before the ball game. So a late September afternoon that still feels like mid-August. I'm sure it really does to the players on the field, so conditioning will definitely play a part in the ball game. Before last year's 35-point win, the previous 5 games between these two teams had been decided by a total of 28 points. This is a 10-point game with 40 seconds to go here in the second quarter. Mustangs, after trailing early on Tony Jeffries' 25-yard touchdown run, have now scored 17 unanswered points to take this 10-point lead as the kickoff will give it to TCU at the 20-yard line. A bad kickoff when you consider Brandy Brownlee booting from his own 35-yard line. That one traveled about 8 yards deep. There is some wind out there today. That's about the only saving grace for the players today. Otherwise, it would be really hot out there. David Rasko back into the game as the quarterback for TCU, and some trouble in the backfield as he and Jeffrey sort of tie up back there, not able to make a clean exchange, and John Eichmann and A.J. Miller were there to bring him down. They did get about a yard out of the play, and the clock is winding down. TCU may not opt to stop it. They have 2 timeouts left, but it continues to run, and they may be content to go into the locker room and regroup after an impressive first quarter. The second quarter has been all SMU. 81-yard drive, 9 plays. It's the second long drive of the afternoon for the Mustangs. Rasko fumbles the ball, but able to pick it up, and that will do it for the first half here at the Cotton Bowl. So a great second quarter for the Mustangs. They score 17 unanswered points and lead TCU 17-7 at halftime. So a lot to talk about for these two coaches as they go into the locker room with their 2 teams. Chuck Curtis is down on the field. We'll be going to him momentarily. Bobby Waters scores a touchdown in that first half on a running play, and he throws a touchdown pass to Kobe Morrison from about 6 yards out. So a very solid performance for the junior from Garland at Lake View Centennial, and a lot of work early on for a fellow named Jeff Atkins. And let's go down to the floor of the Cotton Bowl, where Chuck Curtis is standing by.
like Tony Brown. He gave us some big plays up the middle there in the first half.
He can run inside.
He really can.
Fast finish here, Bobby. Did the first half go about like you planned?
Well, I think, you know, we wanted to get our feet on the ground and establish that. We didn't want to turn the ball over. We wanted to work hard in the kicking game. And I think, you know, we got our feet on the ground. And we didn't want to fall behind, but we did. But, you know, again, I'm proud of the team fighting back and then going ahead and ball.
Bobby, a fast finish. And thank you. And good luck in the second half.
Thank you.
Up to you, Billy Boy. Okay, thank you, Chuck. Good job down there. And Colin's very happy about the second quarter as he leads TCU 17-7. Good first half for the Mustangs. A good first quarter for TCU. Should be a good second half. We'll be back in just a minute. Bill Coates and Chuck Curtis, halftime. Just completed here at the Cotton Bowl as the Mustangs and the Horned Frogs get ready to play second half action. SMU will be kicking off. TCU won the initial toss of the game, elected to defer their option to the second half, so they will receive with Tony Brooks taking it at about the one-yard line, and he will have to hit a knee here and take it at the 20-yard line before a bad mistake happens here. There were no fumbles in that first half. No fumbles lost. There were two TCU fumbles. They did not lose one. In fact, there were no turnovers in that first half. Just some good hard running by the two-star back for each team, and some big plays from SMU. TCU began to go downhill after they missed that field goal, that 14-play drive. They missed the field goal, and they could do nothing after that. David Rasko will open the second half at quarterback. Rasko was 3 of 3, 16 yards passing in the opening half before being replaced by Scott Ankrum. In the backfield with him, Scott Bednarski, who picks up about 3 yards. Chuck Curtis making his way back up to the booth, and he'll be with us in just a moment. Well, Chuck was down on the field, and let's get his thoughts with Jim Wacker.
Okay, aren't you glad they got two Hayes? Hey, are we ever? Our kids played hard first half. We made some mistakes. SMU played awfully well. We're still in the ball game. We plan to win in the second half, Chuck.
What did you tell them at halftime?
We told them we're awful proud of them. They're great, great kids. We just got to eliminate a couple mistakes. We do that, we're right back in the ball game. We're awfully excited. It's going to be a great football game.
Thank you so much. Go. Up to you, Billy Boy.
All right. Good interviews by Chuck with Bobby Collins and Jim Wacker. And Tony Darthard picks up 3, so that'll make it a 3rd and 3. And TCU trying to regain some of that lost momentum. They had an outstanding first quarter, and then it was all SMU after that. 17 straight unanswered points. With Bednarski leaving the game, Jared Delaney wide to the top. Rasko would like to hit him, and will throw out in the flat, and there will be pass interference. As Mark Benson on coverage out there may have gotten a hand on him, and that will most likely be a first down to give the ball to TCU. Chuck Curtis has made his way back up to the booth. Two contrasting styles down there. Collins with very cool, collected self after a very outstanding second quarter, and Wacker always fired up about his team.
That's what I like about both of them. They're such outstanding coaches, and getting an excellent job done and going 90 degrees in different directions.
He gets done.
And Wacker gets a break. Wacker gets a break with that pass interference on Mark Benson, so that's a first down for TCU. You made the point before the half ended that the missed field goal really seemed to take the wind out of the sails of TCU, and they're having to get that back now.
Well, you know, being under Coach Wacker, they're a highly motivated team. I think they were on motivation and on a high in the first quarter, early part of the ball game, so that wore out. And at halftime, I think he probably renewed them. And you can see the results of it here. He got motivated again.
11-yard gain by Tony Jeffrey, who had 64 yards on 10 carries in the first half. De La Garza brought him down. And D'Arthur threw the nice block. So there's two quick first downs, one on a penalty and one on a 12-yard gain from Tony Jeffrey, who's up to unofficially about 74 yards, make that about 76 yards rushing so far.
They're wanting to throw more this last half, and they're wanting to get the ball to Jeffries more.
Well, they'll get better and better.
Both of them very young, as you said, and here's a low end over end kick that Jimmy Young will gamble and take at his own 20-yard line.
I was watching the kicker. It was close to being roughing the kicker, or he did a great job of action. He might have won almost an Oscar on that play.
They could use the roughing the kicker penalty at this point. Jimmy Young, a highly touted young player out of San Antonio, who will be an excellent cornerback at SMU before his career is over. Right now playing behind a good senior, make that a good junior, Mark Benson, who, by the way, will graduate this year and start working on his MBA next year. Plans to play as a graduate student next season. He's watching right now while the Mustang offense goes back to work. They have scored on their last three possessions, and that's Albert Reese, the tight end, in motion. The running backs, Kobe Morrison and Jeff Atkins, and the quarterback, Bobby Waters, for nice yardage, about 8.5. Waters on the straight keeper that time. Mitchell Benson brought him down.
This is something that I watched them do in practice this week. That was the tight end lined up in a slot back formation. He moved to the opposite side of the field, up on the line of scrimmage, tight end, the outside man took a step back to beat, so that both could be an eligible receiver. It made TCU go into an adjusted defense, and they ran right where they adjusted to.
Reese the tight end, Jacobs and Morris the wide receivers. The center is Archie Fairley, who started this week in place of Kim Johnston, and the handoff is to Tony Brown with very little available to him. David Caldwell brought him down, so on second and short, they may have gotten it, but it's going to be close. turn of events. Again, it was becoming dangerously close to a blowout with SMU teetering on the brink of really putting this game away.
Bill Thornton said, if we can just stay patient, stay close, pin their nitty, so to speak, don't beat ourselves, then we're going to be in a football game. And defense, the defense has been giving up the points, that's getting all the blame thus far, comes up here with the big play that sets up a possible touchdown.
Remember earlier we told you that Ben Hummel, their SMU's fine defensive end, had a hit pointer coming into the game today. We've been seeing John Robinson a lot this afternoon for good reason. Hummel has re-aggravated that hit pointer and is out for the rest of the day. So one of SMU's best defensive players is no longer in the football game. And here's seventh down linemen. Horned Frogs have the top scoring team in the Southwest Conference, and there's a fumble on the exchange. We'll see who got it. Rasko in the center, W.C. Nix, never made good connection, and a white shirt and a blue shirt fighting for it down there. The white shirt won. I think Brian Brazel probably came up with a football. Brazel, the junior from Pasadena, becoming one of the outstanding linemen in the Southwest Conference, as you take a look at it.
SMU in a 6'5 defense, crashed submarine. I don't know how that official got under there.
Well, he found out who got it. Here's Davis going for his second touchdown, and he has it. Bobby Davis from 2 yards out behind another Tony Jeffrey block. And now we have a football game again here. It's 24-20 with the extra point to follow.
The old power sweep. I love it. I love it. Against Brownwood one year, we run it 6 times in a row.
And you can, if the blocks are executed properly, you can pick up touchdowns or real big chunks of yards.
Well, on that play, you got lots of security. You got people blocking down. You got folks leading the kick out. And it's a simple pitch.
You get a nice look at the extra point there. It looks good. It is good. Well, from 24-7, two quick TCU third quarter touchdowns and made it a football game again. The Mustangs lead by 3. SMU's in a mess right now. They have surrendered 2 TCU touchdowns, and that last one set up by a Tony Brooks interception return to the 1 yard line. 2 plays later, Bobby Davis scores, and it's 24-21. Mustangs leading by 3. How quickly the fortunes change. Again, we were saying a moment ago, it looked like an easy one for TCU, or an easy one for SMU with 24 unanswered points.
I think right now SMU's pressing a little bit. Footwaters, and he knows that, he's made a mistake. And you make a mistake down that territory to a nifty little running back like Brooks, and, you know, it's a touchdown turnaround.
And especially against a young team like TCU that needs only a shot in the arm of confidence to get rolling. It's been 14 years since they've won this football game. You give them an inch, and they might take a mile. Here's Lee Newman kicking off again. Remember, this series had been close up until last year when SMU won 56-21. This is Jimmy Young, and he's met at the 25-yard line. Greg Moore stopped his progress. That's the understatement of the afternoon. Jimmy Young was running a pretty good chase until he met Mr. Moore, and he gained no more yardage there.
Both special teams, I've been impressed on how they have been improved just through a week of concentration and work and just spotlighting.
Craig Kennington, Kevin McKinney along the front line. That was a very short scoring drive, as you can see. Archie Fairley, Rod Mounce, big 300-pound David Richards along the SMU front. Morris in motion out of the eye. They go back to Atkins, who hasn't done a great deal in the second half so far. Atkins tackled by Mitchell Benson, so you go back to the bread and butter when you get in a little trouble. You feel pretty safe when that guy's carrying the football.
They told Jeff to forget those fumbles and start running and using that old good natural talent that the good Lord blessed you with.
He has plenty of that. 21 carries, 76 yards. Has already passed Alvin Maxson into fifth place on the all-time SMU running list. Has over 2,700 career yards in his stay at SMU. This is Jed Martin. A big, big game for Martin. He may go all the way. Scored one last year against TCU and gets it to the 18. Not that fast, and that's the only thing that saved a touchdown. It's Landon Newton. Finally brought him down.
Pretty nifty play. The tight end lined up as a slot back.
formation, guess who? Atkins again, but not first down yardage on this carry, although he appears to have the nose of the football inside the 10. David Caldwell brought him down, and the clock winding down. They'll have to get off another play before the third quarter ends. It's now under 19 seconds to go, or at least they would appear to have to. I don't find the 25-second clock just real handy to look at.
I think they got a little late putting the ball into play.
Yeah,
they're going to burn this quarter.
They'll burn the quarter up. Okay, that's all right. That'll save a good final 15 minutes for us here at the Cotton Bowl. SMU and TCU have turned this one into a good one. So we'll go into the fourth quarter with this game still very much hanging in the balance. The Mustangs lead TCU 20.
We're excited about coming to the Cotton Bowl this year. This is the Cotton Bowl championship of the Metroplex.
That's right. In fact, you felt that in the locker room that both these teams were excited about the change of atmosphere. Here's a third and one, and the atmosphere starting to build for Jeff Atkins as he goes for first down yardage. Should have it on second and third effort as Andy Pitts brings him down. Atkins with up around 90 yards rushing right now. Atkins in the first ball game, the first game against Rice, ran for 132 yards. Last week, got 73 more, and he's at about 90 right now. It's first and goal inside the 10-yard line to the 7, inside the 7 actually, and here is Bobby Waters operating out of the Power Eye setup. Brown, Kobe Morrison, Atkins ball loose for a moment, nothing there, brought down by Kevin Dean. Had he not fumbled, maybe there would have been something there, but that slowed the progress, and Atkins wisely just worried more about getting the ball back than trying to get any yardage out of it.
You know, had he taken it away from the tailback, we might have another touchdown here for SMU. They've got lots of confidence in that power eye. They can run the option, they can throw, they can run the quick trap, they can run the halfback hip. So many things they can do out of it, and it's all high security.
And they can also throw. We'll see here.
Two tight ends. Tough yardage.
Tough yardage inside the 10. We talked about that a moment ago in the first half when they had first and goal at the 10. They scored that time. They'll throw this time. Wide open. Touchdown. It's Albert Reese from Bobby Waters, who for the second time today has completely fooled TCU on play action pass.
That was the bootleg. All the flow went to the right. He fakes to the tailback and then comes back to the offside. Dumps it. Wide open. Touchdown. Pretty, pretty, pretty.
Only the second touchdown pass in Reese's career. The other one came last year against TCU. And Brandy Brownlee's on, and now the game becomes a 9-point, maybe a 10-point game again. And the win goes out of TCU sails a bit. It is a 10-point game, 31-21. The Mustangs come right back following the TCU score. Give Bobby Waters a lot of credit. He throws the interception. They score, but he comes right back, and now it's a 31-21 SMU lead. One of the deep receivers for TCU, along with Reggie Davis, Brandy Brownlee, will kick off. He plays in that drive. Well, the big play was the touchdown play, where the bootleg from Bobby Waters worked just like it was drawn up to Reese.
Fooled everybody, and they had to have execution. In fact, he probably could have ran it in, but went ahead and threw it.
Reese has two catches for 62 yards, including that tip pass that set up the last score for SMU. Morris, four catches for 64. Here's the kickoff. Petrie, the new deep man in the formation for TCU, has some running room to the outside, out to the 32-yard line. Al Brown threw one of the blocks, and it may have been an illegal one because there's a flag down. Somebody guilty of holding. That's the second time that's happened to TCU this afternoon. Hurt them both times. This will cost them 10 yards.
Hurts every time you penalize. That's from an old coach's standpoint. You know, they detected it. They detected always at the most inopportune time.
Holding. Getting the run back. First down.
Yeah, and it's one of those penalties that it seems to happen over and over and over again. Hard to correct. Penalty is definitely in the SMU's favor here. Four of them for 45 yards for TCU, including two kickoff holding penalties that we told you about. Tony Jeffrey, 12 carries for 85 yards. He's in there. They'll pitch, though, to Bobby Davis with Jeffrey the lead blocker. Davis has two touchdown runs and some yardage here.
He was gearing down. He was gearing down, man, to try to make the cut, and the pursuit came in, and it almost was a big play, let me tell you.
A.J. Miller brought him down. Davis has definitely shown the ability to go outside, hasn't he?
He's got the speed, and he can go for the long distance.
Bednarski back in the game, and Tony Darthard has checked out. And again, Wacker can show us one thing. He definitely has a stable of solid running backs, and he is getting the personnel around them to match as well, particularly along the offensive line. They can move the football. Bednarski in motion out of the split backs here. Ratko will go up top, or Delaney again overthrows him, but there may be a holding penalty against SMU because there's a flag down at the 40. Vincent on coverage again. Delaney caught that long pass from Ratko earlier, and they tried to hit him again down the sideline, but there's a flag down, and you would wonder if perhaps it is against SMU's cornerback.
Let's see if we can figure it out, because Delaney is the long ball catcher. Didn't see it. It happened. Good ways back up the field.
Good ways back up the field, but it may be in TCU's favor. After the man gets 3 yards past the line of scrimmage, you can no longer grab him. You can do it within that little zone area there, but after that, you can't hold him anymore. You can block him, but you can't grab him.
Well, he was about to...
10-yard holding before the ball was thrown. Automatic first down.
Okay.
He was about to beat Mark Benson, and Mark tried to grab a hold as he went by.
Well, they didn't get the long pass they wanted, but they get 10 yards. They get a first down. They need 10 points. 31-21. The Mustangs with the lead. Here's Davis to the short side of the field again. Not much working this time. De La Garza, Harmon, and others bring him out of bounds. Frankie Thomas in there also. Rudy Harmon, also a backup linebacker last year behind some good players that SMU had as starters. They were playing 3-4 alignment last year, and these guys have just been chomping at the bit to try to become starters. They all run very well, Chuck. They really cover a lot of ground.
Those good linebackers, you can play them anywhere because they're good football players. They wouldn't ever have been playing linebackers.
De La Garza, Masterson, Harmon still in there. Ratko wants to throw it over the middle. Has his man? No. Ricky Stone had it for a moment and couldn't hang on. Frankie Thomas was around him. Ricky Stone has started since his freshman year, and there is a flag down in TCU's backfield again. Well, there are always several possibilities in the backfield, including personal foul against the defense. And I'm wondering if that's what happened. Maybe a late hit. Look at Miller coming from behind. Oh, you can barely see it, Chuck, in the background, but I bet he hit him late.
Ricky Stone's going to have bad dreams about that play for a long time because it was almost spectacular.
Personal foul, roughing the passer, first down.
But good thing he came out of it for TCU.
Yeah, you could see A.J. Miller. Just before we pan downfield with the shot, you could see Miller get real close to David Ratko, and I'll bet he was the guy who was guilty there. Coming from behind, A.J. Miller. And TCU moving it inside the 50. Here they go again. It's Bednarski, who has had a good day so far. De La Garza will bring him down.
They've had more success on the inside of ball than on the outside.
That's right, they have. And that has been in the Tulane game. They also had a couple of long runs on the inside. Only Jeffrey did that. 10 carries for 54 yards. Jeffrey had 280-plus runs in that 343-yard game against Tulane. This time he is going outside. Has over 80 yards. He will get the first down, picking his way off right tackle on the little sweep, the little toss sweep. And Jeffrey can
with his hands. He doesn't have them taped up like those big defensive linemen do. He should have had that one.
Coach Collins still mad, and I don't know why. He's feeling like he's been mistreated on this drive. Here's
Bobby Waters, his 19th pass of the afternoon. No fumble and recovered by TCU with flags down.
Now, Bobby Waters has been mistreated.
David Caldwell, one of the ones who mistreated him. Caldwell ended up recovering the fumble. If that penalty is against SMU, then TCU has the ball back and a chance to cut this lead down. Here's the replay.
Oh, howdy. You know, it's a fumble.
Hard to see who made contact. I think Tracy Simeon. I'm almost, here's another angle. Simeon, Tracy Simeon, the sophomore from Sweeney, was the man who made contact. And David Caldwell recovered the fumble. And the penalty was against SMU.
Benson was in there real close on that, too. He is a contributor.
All right. Well, Horned Frog's not dead yet. They have it at their own 49. Rasko still the engineer. Bednarski still the fullback for maybe 2 yards there. Robert McDade and Toby Watts in there. A couple of second-line defensive linemen up there. McDade, number 70, played as a freshman last year. He's in the game along with John Eichmann. We'll set some of the other defenders. Donald Allen out of Fort Worth is one of the linebackers. Toby Watts along the defensive front line. A.J. Miller, those are the front four. Rasko will keep it himself, and not much available. Maybe another yard before A.J. Miller brings him down along with...
I think you did a good job of stringing out the option play. The down people are supposed to stop the dive, man. You usually have a linebacker that's responsible for the quarterback, and then the cornerback or even strong safety is responsible for the pitch man. Everybody took care of their own business on that play.
Randy Garrett, the middle linebacker, number 49. David West, number 52, also went on that last stop. So a complete new front seven for SMU. And here's pressure on Rasko, and Harold Mann, who came back into the ball game, gets the sack. Ball and Mann were back into the game, and they got the pressure in.
Well, they just got a little rest, you know. They just got a little renewed vigor there and came back in and put the hurt to them.
Third down and a bunch, and that makes it fourth down with a big sack from Mann. And here's another punting situation, so the turnover maybe will not cost SMU anything except a little field position as Becker comes on. Jimmy Young will drop deep at his own 20-yard line, so the SMU defense rises up to hold. Following the Bobby Waters fumble, and Becker's kick is a high one, not that deep. Young, will fall forward and gamble a little bit and take it at the 18-yard line. 8:07 to play in the fourth quarter. We've had a good one this afternoon. It's not over yet, but SMU is certainly in control right now with a ball and a 10-point lead. Benson brings it down. Bobby Collins will definitely let that clock run at this point, I would think, and be a little more conservative. And that's just a guess on my part, but I would think, knowing Bobby, that might be a strategy he would take right now.
I think you're absolutely correct. They'd like to get another first down or two and use up, get down into the 2 minute area before they get the football back up to TCU. The
Mustangs have really shown us, again, the ability to throw the ball with Waters this afternoon. 11 of 19, but no gambles with Jeff Atkins normally as he works his way out for about seven more. He'll be about a yard and a half shy. Kevin McKinney throws a nice block. A two-year starter out of Porter. And that'll leave third down and short, and here's a play that SMU really needs to burn up two or three more minutes on that clock.
You know, Bill, that same play we're seeing right now, they've got the pass play off of it, and they call it the waggle. They may want
31-21. And a full timeout coming up here as Mitchell Benson limps off but walks off under his own power. Bonner's now 11 of 18, 187. We gave that one to you a moment ago. He tried for his 19th pass, and that was the one that, before he could get it off, the one that the Tracy Simeon jarred the ball away from him, and he fumbled. Well, while they take a break, why don't we also, you see Bobby Waters talking to Bobby Collins, happy about the way things are going. They have a third down and long upcoming, but they lead 31-21. Be okay. It's third down and 10 for the Mustangs. 69th meeting between these two. SMU holds the series lead. They've won 14 in a row, trying to make it 15. Tony Brown off the draw. They'll have to punt. It'll be fourth down. Nothing available. Frank Hawkins, another tackle. And here comes Dodge Carter. And so TCU will get the ball back with still a lot of time left on the clock. Plenty of time for something good to happen for TCU and bad for SMU. A lot of time available.
You know, third and 10 situation, you don't have many of those plays in your playbook. They took the safe route, so it's the draw that works. It's top, makes a good yard, and he doesn't time.
This is the same young man who returned that interception a while ago, Tony Brooks, and here he's trying to do it again. What move! Look at him! Flags down, maybe some illegal blocks thrown down there, but Tony Brooks, that was one of the most spectacular 9-yard returns you'll ever see.
His blockers didn't know which way to block because he was dipping and starting and going one direction and the other direction, and that's highly possible, but he sure is excited.
As a clip, coaches don't like to see on returns too much east-west running, really, do they?
No, sooner or later you got to go north and south, and that's where the blood and guts are.
And the clip, when you start freelancing like that, that's what breaks up the punt coverage, and you generally get a clip, and that's what happens here.
But he's a little light back.
The team on the run back, first down.
He's a little light back, and he'll make the big plays, and he's the type that can do that to your business.
Well, instead of field position outside the 30, it is now first and 10 TCU at their own 23, 4:47 on the clock, and time is starting to become a factor. Bednarski, Bobby Davis, and Tony Jeffrey, the three running backs who have had the most success this afternoon for TCU. And Jeffrey, their national rushing leader, gets near first down yardage. That's a pickup of about 9 yards, maybe a first down. Derek Reed ran him out of bounds. In fact, I'll have Jim Davis give me the stats on not only Jeffrey, but the other two running backs, Bednarski and Bobby Davis. Coming into the game, TCU was leading the Southwest Conference in rushing, averaging almost 430 yards a game on the ground. 11 for 56 yards for Bednarski, 8 for 31, 2 touchdowns for Bobby Davis, and for Tony Jeffrey, another 100-yard game, 14 carries, 100 yards. He now has 497 for the season in 3 ball games. And here's Bednarski on first down with only a couple of yards available. Running at the left side of the SMU defensive line, and we will set some of their defenders. They've been making some changes. That was the second down and short. Sorry, check that. Now it's the first down. Reggie Ballard has come into the ballgame. Ballard has had some knee problems. That was a second and short, not a first and 10 second, but now it's first.
Carter. They're going to have to hit the big play. But, of course, SMU's giving them a little yardage. They're giving them those passes up in front now where they just don't want to give up a touchdown.
Wishbone backfield, Delaney, the wide receiver, Davis, the runner inside the 40 for about five more. Hey, they'll let him have five all day as long as he stays in bounds, I would think.
Yeah, and SMU wasn't going to let him get out of bounds. And Mark Vincent came up from the outside, and then the pursuit from the inside out was Ball and company, and he was surrounded.
Jerry Ball in there. He has been allowed to take some rest this afternoon, but having another outstanding game along with Terrence Mann, John Robinson, John Eichmann in the game, number 65. Jeffrey collared by Mann, gotten away from him, but De La Garza wouldn't let him get away. That will be short of the first down, so it'll now be third and short.
I was watching
the clock keeps rolling.
Excuse me, I was watching Ball then, and he slanted to the right side of the field, and, you know, Nix has been talking all week about wanting to play in front of Jerry Ball. On that particular play, the opportunity was there.
And another timeout. TCU has only one left. Well, I better check myself. Scoreboard says two. It is a TCU timeout to stop the clock with 2:39 left to play here in the fourth quarter, 31-21. You were making a point during the last timeout about Bobby Collins and his program to avoid injuries, because depth is not something that TCU has or SMU has a lot of this year.
They're really emphasizing their out-of-season program, injury prevention. All this past year and the start of the season, they've worked extra hard, and they've spotlighted it, and as a result today, they don't have any injuries.
Immediately following tonight's telecast, mad scientist Boris Karloff tampers with Mother Nature and prolongs human life with a menacing freeze machine. Thrills and chills in the man with nine lives. Next. TCU thinking they may have nine lives, be like a cat. They're trying to bounce back. They've been behind most of the afternoon after leading early in this football game. SMU scored 24 in a row. TCU came back to make it 24-21, and then SMU scored to make it 31-21. Here's a third down and about three. Rasko, who's 7 of 10 passing under heavy pressure, will throw it up. He has Waddy, but knocked away at the last minute down there by Frankie Thomas. Nice defensive play. I'm not sure Waddy would have been in bounds or that he would have been able to catch up with it anyway. But A.J. Miller and company giving chase back there, and that fouled up the play. So now it's fourth down at four. That's an awfully long field goal for Lee Newman, so you can expect TCU to go for it here. They need a touchdown and not much time available. They do have only one timeout left. Scoreboard was a little slower than I was that last time. Jeffrey with 107 yards rushing, Atkins with 100, but at this juncture, that means absolutely nothing. Out of the wishbone, here's Jeffrey going for the first down, didn't get it. Unless they let him roll for it, he didn't get it. The man out there was Derek Reed, who made a very nice tackle, and that could salt it away for SMU. They get a nice ovation from their fans, and some of them starting to leave, because that may have been the clincher. Derek Reed just dropped his head and went right at the ankles of Tony Jeffrey, and Tony may have 110 yards plus tonight, but that's not the one. He needed about 111, and he didn't quite get it that time to make the first down. So he comes up short on fourth down, and the Mustangs and Bobby Waters take over at their own 34-yard line with really nothing to do but run out the clock, keep the football. Tony Brown will get 7. Chuck has left us to make his way down toward the field. He will talk to the winning coach, and unless something drastic happens at this point, it will be Bobby Collins. 2:12 and counting, only one timeout left for TCU, and first down will probably... Well, they might not be able to run another. TCU might never get the ball back if SMU can get one first down out of it. Second down and three, under 2 minutes to go. Jeff Atkins and Jed Martin, the running backs, double tight ends, Shelman and Tony Shelman and Albert Reese. A long count for Waters. Atkins has the first down, has a lot of running room inside the 50, and they'll move the sticks. That may be the first down that keeps the ball for the rest of the afternoon. Also for Atkins, who has had great success with 100-yard days. This is his 13th. And unless something changes, the Mustangs will be 12-1 wins and losses when he has 100-yard days. He had 30 carries for 113 yards. Now, straight ahead power running for Atkins and a He's done very well this afternoon also. Second and four, under a minute to go, and this one all but over here at the Cotton Bowl. But a good football game. The Mustangs will keep it on the ground. Tony Brown with helmet flying one direction and him going in the other. Hornfrogs don't appear anxious to stop the clock here, and there may not be another play in this football game. Now it appears TCU will call timeout. They will delay it one more play. 23 seconds left, and this one is just about over. So the timeout with a third and four facing SMU, and really nothing left but to run out the clock with a 31-21 victory. Not a bad way to bounce back for the Mustangs. They beat Rice 45-3 in the opener 2 weeks ago. Lost last week out at Arizona State 30-0 in a game that wasn't as lopsided as the score would indicate. The stat sheet not that much in favor of Arizona State. A couple of long punt returns, a couple of fumbles inside the 10-yard line hurt SMU. Today they come out and TCU scored first. They actually led 7-3 at the end of the first quarter, and then 24 unanswered points for the Mustangs to make it a very lopsided game at that point, it appeared. Then two touchdowns for TCU made it 24-21, and then the Mustangs scored to make it 31-21 as you take a look at the graphic for each of these outstanding rushers for these two football teams. Jeffrey up over 500 yards in only three football games. And Jed Martin crashes at the point of attack and not much available for him, but that should be the last play of the football game. So this 69th meeting between